Welcome to the Anime Reviewers. I'm Matt.
I'm Zach.
Today we're talking about Jujutsu Kaisen, Episode 10, Idol Transfiguration.
So, the synopsis for this episode is it intros with a very compelling parallel scene between Yoshino and Itadori. It's focused on Yoshino, but there's definitely parallels to Itadori there. We get a little bit more of Yoshino and Mahito talking, because the last episode ended with them talking, and this sort of like is a continuation of their conversation. We also get to see the start of the interaction between Itadori and Yoshino. It's basically just their meeting. There's nothing more than, I mean, there's a little bit more to it than I'm Itadori, like. But they don't really go in depth conversation with that. Like, it's just sort of it covers their initial meeting, and then the bulk of this episode is focused on a fight between Nanami Kento and the curse Mahito. And hot, oh, such a good fight.
Yep.
You get to learn about Mahito's power. You get to see a lot of what Nanami Kento can do. It's just so good.
The first memorable moment for me was just right off the beginning was that what I like. I immediately had that impression of this is an excellent parallel of Itadori and Yoshino, and from the shots that show the high school, and then they go to a room, a hallway of the high school, and then they go to a room that's exactly like the room from the first episode with his friends, where they're having their little club.
It's like a movie review club, I think.
Well, yeah, it's a movie book. Thank you.
For Yoshino, it's a movie review club. Yeah. For Itadori, it was the
it's a
paranormal investigation club.
Yes. And then just the like interactions he's having with his friends, where he's talking about the movie. He's very passionate about the movie, and like just the endless amount of parallels to where Itadori is focused on people. He's at that club because he likes his friends. He's indifferent about the paranormal stuff.
Yeah.
But where Yoshino is in there because he likes movies. He's talking about Scary Movie 7, I think, is what they're referring, like.
It's Horror Movie 7 is what they call it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's essentially Scary Movie 7.
Oh, okay. I thought they said Scary. Could be.
I thought they said Horror Movie 7. But they also make reference to the fact that it's not even, like,
it's not a good movie and nobody would ever see it.
Well, not even just that. It's no longer a parody movie series anymore.
Yeah.
Which is what Scary Movie was meant to be, like, the...
It's kind of like watching and listening to someone who cares and is passionate about talking about the subject. And
you mean like our show? Or...
Yes.
Are we paralleling ourselves here?
And then it's reinforced more because then some bullies come in to take the room. Again, paralleling the first episode with Itadori, but instead of someone trying to take him, they're trying to take the club away from him. Most specifically, the room. They say that's their room, and he's like, "You haven't been using it." When they're clearly just after him, and they're just trying to bully this kid. And the portrayal of bullying at that moment was they again, like, I really applaud them because of how they're after him because of their, like, it's clear that they're like the insecurities of themselves, and he has like this passion and they have no passion. They hadn't been using the room.
Yeah.
And it's so subtle. There's no, he doesn't like have some psychiatrist sit here and like, oh, I'm gonna talk. It's so subtle and how true to bullies are there, where they have like this jealousy and everyone's after this kid because he's an outsider and he's different, so they watch him. They're always watching him and paying attention to him because he's an outsider, because he's different. Not because not necessarily because they particularly care or something like that, but because it's different. You're going to look, if a fire truck drives through your neighborhood, even if it's not blaring a siren, you're going to notice it, to where if a car goes by, you're probably not going to notice it.
Yeah. And, like, for me, what I really enjoyed about that parallel is actually something you briefly mentioned, is the fact that, like, Itadori, like, back when he was at his old school, like, he was also seen as an outsider. But for him being an outsider, he was more sought after or praised. Like, not necessarily praised, but, like, he was definitely sought after for being an outsider. Because the athletic coach comes and goes, oh, no, you're going to join my team. Like,
I rigged it to where you signed up for my team. I changed what you did. And I also really like that is the fact that, like, we're not only do they have parallels, but we're also seeing, like, a little bit of differences in them. So Yoshino's seen as an outsider and bullied and beat down for it, whereas Itadori is seen as an outsider and people want to make use of him or praise him, kind of, you know. So as much as there are parallels between the two, I'm also really enjoying the subtle
differences.
Yeah. And how those differences, like, you could see, like, if it happens time and again, like, repetitively. And as we've seen with Yoshino, he's been repetitively beat. As we've seen with Itadori and how it's been explained, he's been repetitively praised for his strength. Like, how that continuation of, like, those small instances can create those, like, different mindsets that they have. Even if they're walking down the same, like, similar roads.
Yeah, that's where, like, that's where, like, their parallels are so well done, too, is... There's this great scene at the very end where the bully's standing on a DVD or a Blu-ray or some sort of cake
sort of movie.
He's had his foot on it, and Yoshida's going to give up the room. He doesn't want to get beat up. He doesn't want to deal with it, because especially since his friends are pushing him to do it. He's just going to walk away, but he wants something. He wants, like, a piece. He wants some sort of victory in that defeat, and he demands the movie because he cares about that movie. And you can see he's obviously upset about it, and it's very similar. It's a parallel, I think, a very good parallel to Itadori, where Itadori was there for his friends, he's there, it reinforces that he's there for the movies. He cares about his friends. His friends are able to take him out of, like, talk about that situation. And
up until he
disregards them, too, at that. He wants something. He wants that movie back.
And that's so well done. I think the next memorable stuff, the next memorable scene for me, takes place, you know, basically right after, is that continuation of the conversation between Yoshino and Mahito. And my big takeaway, because there's a lot of stuff that they cover there, my big takeaway for that one that I felt was very compelling and very interesting is Yoshino talks about, like, having these, like, basically the dark impulses to, like, you know, kill someone or something. And Mahito is basically endorsing it and says, what is his wording? Because it's so good. It's not I condone it. It's not I support you. I can't remember his wording. I really wish
didn't
I could.
Didn't he say Anderson?
No. He said something different. Like, the wording is very particular, and it's really, really good, and I really wish I could remember it right now.
That's a memorable moment.
It's a memorable moment. I'm just terrible with, like, the words, but, like, the point of that interaction is basically, like, and again, it's reinforcing the parallels we talked about. That's what it was for me, but the fact that, like, Mahito is basically going, go and kill. It's okay. You can do it. Like, it's fine. You eat food, you can kill people.
That's, like, what I really like about it. It keeps reinforcing the parallels between Itadori and Yoshino, is every time, like, Itadori's been told to restrain himself.
Yeah.
And to essentially, like, actually take some time to think about things and like, don't be so impulsive. Where Yoshino is now being taught to act on his impulses and to act, and like, and it's like, in a sense, like, it's a good way, the way you would want to approach a kid like him is to give him permission to be himself, because he's reserving himself so much, and to where Itadori does need to slow down a little bit and think things through a little bit, because, like, I mean, obviously he's not going to be able to completely do it, but, like, look at the mess he got himself into, and this kid is being given permission, and and that's why he's drawn to, like, these terrible people, or this terrible creature, because it's a curse.
Yeah.
And I just love that. It was such a, again, it just reinforces the parallel between the two characters, and how similar they are.
Yeah.
It's literally their mirror reflections of each other, with, only subtle differences, and it shows how, like, in the intro, they're in some way going to be friends. Like, and it's gonna, and that's what I like. It's really building that up well. And then the next memorable moment for me is, like, immediately after that scene, which is still part of the same scene where he shows him
Mahito
shows Yoshino, like, his powers on a small scale, but he gives him misleading. And that's what I love is in the previous episode, or maybe it was two episodes ago, they talked about how, like, or no, it was the previous episode. You talk about getting your powers. Oh, showing your hand can actually be a good idea because you're...
Yeah, it's in the previous one, yeah.
Yeah, where you're misleading your...
It can be misleading.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's the thing. It's like he's clear, and that's happened previously in the episode or in the show.
Yep.
Where they talked about powers, but they didn't tell you exactly how they worked and led you on to what they are. Even the villains characters have done the same thing. They lied about how their powers worked, and that kind of makes me wonder about his powers. It's like, is he really able to manipulate the soul like he claims? It's just an interesting comparison too of how when he talks to the kid. He talks to him and tells him he can just change the body, he can manipulate the bodies. But when he talks at the end of the episode during the fight, that we'll get more into, is he says he can manipulate
the... He's manipulating the soul.
Yeah, his powers affect the soul. And I'm like, that. I'm like, oh, there's more to his powers.
Oh, yeah.
That really was just so... And then he talks about his... Basically philosophizes this guy in... and basically gives him I'm pretty confident it's nihilism because he's basically saying
everything sucks. Yeah,
everything, but not everything sucks. Nothing's important.
Yeah, that's right.
It's nature. Important. Nature is just nature, and it's moving. You are just part of that.
Yeah.
I love how like that. That's such an excellent depiction of the misunderstandings of nihilism.
Yes.
Of how like, oh yeah, go along with nature so I can just be horrible. Absolutely atrocious person. So I'm nature. I can carve a path through this pristine place, or I can do whatever I want because I am a part of this.
Yeah.
It's just like you're justifying being a terrible person that society has deemed that we shouldn't be doing, and in some cases, absolutely do that.
Yeah.
Carve that path, blaze that new trail. On other ends, genocide is horrible.
Yeah.
Which is basically his philosophy dumbing down to.
Yeah.
And I love that. Like, how he basically is convincing this kid that genocide is okay.
Yeah.
And it's everyone who hates me, is so, and it shows how, like, and like he said that line, or the kid, Yoshido, said that earlier. And how that reflects so well on how easy it is to fall into those traps.
Yes.
Of ideology. And then there's the most memorable moment is the fight scene between Mojito and Nanami. That fight was incredible.
Yeah, oh, so great.
And the opening line is my favorite part of the whole thing. If you had been Satoru, I might have been in trouble.
I
would have been in trouble.
Mojito specifically says, is very specific about that. But that fight's great. Mojito more explains his powers, where what he's actually, like, modifications he's doing are to the soul, which in turn affects the body. He's not manipulating the body, that's not what his power is, what he's affecting is the soul, and he also continues to philosophize even there. Because at that point, like, over in that fight, he's talking to Adonami about which do you think came first, the soul or the body? The body or the soul is what he says.
And then it compares to the old chicken and the egg thing.
Which is...
I'm too much of a nerd to tell you a chicken can exist and exist without a chicken egg, but chicken egg can't exist without a chicken.
Yes. And Adonami answers the question wrong. Adonami says the body came first, and, you know... We also get to see, like, how he can manipulate the soul, like, in a much bigger way. It's still pretty small scale, I'm guessing, in comparison to the reality of his powers, but in a much, like, more unique manner, I guess I should say, compared to what we've seen up till now, which is, oh, let me just do minor transfigurations, or, hey, let me show you this, because he showed it to Yoshino, this really, like, let me see how big I can make one human being, let me see how small I can make another, like, now we're seeing him, like, because it turns out he carries, like, small versions of people that he shrunk down and manipulates them as weapons and, like, to reach out and, like, swing arms and extend and do all these, like,
And
they're still alive. And I like the fact that he doesn't have 100% control over his power. He has 100% control over the transfiguration aspect of it, but not the aspect of, like, affecting the mind part. Like, he outright says... I haven't quite grasped that yet. Because, like, all these people that are deformed still have the ability to, like, talk. Not like, proper communication, but, like, they start leaking out certain things. Like, the thing that one of the people that he ends up using says, help me to Nanami.
Which, that's something I really love, is how it shows how, like, he is so evil and also smart, where he's testing the waters with Nanami. Not only destroying his, like, cursed human things that he went and showed Yoshido. And then he tries to, like, play it, see if he... Then he tests the water to see if he cares about these people. And he's just like, this doesn't bother me. Like, this is my job.
What I like is Mahito called him out on it. Nanami says it doesn't. Mahito goes, I can see your soul shaking. And I like the fact that they don't, like... It's not some throwaway line, because after he says that, you then see Nanami wipe away a tear off this, like, deformed human. So, Mahito is actually correct. It does bother Nanami. But I think it bothers Nanami to the core of who he is, not his analytical mind, that he hyper-focused on, if that makes sense. Because, like, he's a hyper-analytical individual. And it's why, like, he doesn't... Like, he wants out of the fight with Mahito very quickly after he figures out what Mahito's power is. Because Nanami's power, it's a bad matchup. Because Nanami's power is what he says it in the last episode, but it's called 7 of 3, which is basically he takes measurements of people and he goes like if you're looking at like ruler or something, like it's 7 down. And if he hits that spot, it does a critical hit. Which does far more damage than what he can actually output. Because Mahito deforms, reshapes, and changes everything, it's a bad matchup. Because for Nanami, he needs to know the anatomy of what he's fighting and its specific dimensions in order... But if its dimensions are always changing, that 7 of 3 mark is going to keep, like...
Well, and ultimately, the critical damage he's able to inflict isn't going to be permanent because he can heal himself. Because he cuts off his hand and then he heals himself.
Well, it's like dangling. But actually, Mahito actually outright says, I'm not healing myself. Overextending the manipulation of my soul. So he's not healing the damage. He's manipulating his own soul to correct the imperfection.
That's why he's all stitched together.
I think that's why he's all stitched together. It's he's not healing. He's basically, because from his perspective, the soul, like the body is a shell around the soul. The soul comes first, then the body is formed. So whatever the body looks like is simply the manifestation of the soul. So he manipulates the soul in order to change, like that's how he does it. It's just so good. I want to keep talking about it, but
that's just one quick point to I also feel that like Nanami is also a parallel of Itadori in a way of like what he could be in his future, where he has those same feelings as Itadori, where he gets shaken to his very core. Nanami even says that about Itadori, about how he gets mad because
it's genuinely mad.
Yeah,
it's not I'm mad because you're my friend. It's he's outright truly angry, and it's not for his friends, it's for those humans that were turned into curses. It's people Itadori didn't know. He was truly angry for them.
And I just liked how he like, and I say that because like not only is a weapon choice, like he's got a little blade just,
and he's got a butcher knife that's very reminiscent of
the weapon
Demon Slaughterer.
I think that's part of the reason why, because it's Satoru is like a very smart, they show how smart he is.
So smart.
And since he can see everything, he can see the parallels and connect all. Like, and I love how there's just like, there's all these little things that connect. And it's.
And the next memorable thing for me is really the, basically where the show ends. Because early on, Nanami says, I started work at 10 a.m., I'm clocking out at 6, no matter what. And he gets chased in they're in a sewer system. He gets chased into this big, like, reservoir looking thing kind of room.
That looks just like the room they fought the cursed woman. It really does.
It looks very similar, yeah. But that sort of expansive area. And he looks at his watch and it, like, takes a couple seconds, but then it clicks 6 o'clock. And you see him, like, putting away the knife and, like, undoing his tie. You're like, are you really just about to, like, for,
that's what I thought.
There's a split second where I thought he's like, all right, I'm walking away. And no, he takes off his tie, wraps it around his fist, and all of a sudden, like, we see his cursed energy, like, envelop him entirely. And even Mahito goes, gets paused by it for a moment, because, like, his cursed energy is expanding. And he's like, looks like I'm going into overtime. And that's where it ended, and I was so, so angry.
Yeah,
it's so good, but I was so like, I just
And like that's where I really applaud this show is that pacing. I want to watch I want to binge watch this, and like I want to watch the next episode. And this is like this episode just came out at our head recently.
It came out today.
Oh yeah,
came out today. As of recording this episode, it came out today.
Yes. Oh yeah. So it came out at the very day of recording. We're recording this episode. And I would totally be back way after seeing the first couple episodes. I know I mentioned this. I would binge watch this.
Oh, yeah, I
would have waited just to binge watch the whole thing because of how good everything has been.
Yeah. But that's going to be it for us from today.
Yeah.
Have a good one.
Bye-bye. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe.
And hit that bell icon for notifications. Also follow us on Twitter and Facebook. Links in the description down below.